When trying to understand the shape of these three-dimensional graphs, it can be helpful to reduce it back to two-dimensional shapes. One way of doing that is by creating traces. Here's the definition. Definition: a trace of a function f of two independent variables x and y in the x direction is a curve of the form z equals f of x c, where c is a constant. Similarly, a trace of the function f in two independent variables x and y in the y direction is a curve of the form z equals f of c y, where c is a constant. This is a lot of words, so what does it mean? Let's focus on the first part. We're evaluating the function along points of the form x c. In other words, we fix the y value, and we're letting the x value be free to move. It's a trace in the x direction because the movement is in the x direction. Notice that the points xc are points along the line y equals c. We are seeing what the function is doing as we move along that line. Another way of saying this is that we're looking at where the surface intersects the plane y equals c. Visually, this picture feels odd because our two images aren't lined up with each other. This is just something you're going to have to get used to. You will want to practice visually rotating pictures so that the axes line up. For this picture, if you wanted to make them line up better, you can rotate the two-dimensional picture so that the positive x-axis points down, which is more like having the positive x-axis pointing towards you. The second part of the definition is the same idea, just with the x-coordinate fixed and the y-coordinate free to move. Notice that we've oriented the two-dimensional picture in the conventional way, and we'll leave it as a mental exercise for you to line them up. You may want to pause the video for a moment and do that quick exercise. We've actually seen these traces already, but we didn't bring any attention to them. When we were graphing by plotting points, we created a grid of values, and then we also showed a graph of the function. We'll draw on the trace in the x direction along y equals 2 and highlight those values in the chart. The graph has many more points plotted than what the chart shows, but you can see the pattern of values increasing and then decreasing again. You can also see that we can derive the formula for the trace by simply substituting the appropriate value in for y. In the same way, we can do a trace in the y direction by fixing x to be equal to 1. This corresponds to a row of values on our chart. In fact, the graph itself is nothing more than a large collection of traces. You should practice mentally tracing the shapes of the parabolas going in both the x and the y directions. This is a skill that you can develop over time so that you can more easily visualize three-dimensional graphs. You can further build this intuition by looking at common objects and imagine that you're slicing them into pieces and trying to visualize what each of those slices would look like. All of this helps to build your three-dimensional visualization skills and intuition. A similar concept to traces is that of a level curve. Traces are what you get when you slice a graph using planes with either the x or the y variable being fixed. A level curve is what you get when you slice a graph using planes with the z variable being fixed. In other words, a level curve tells us all the points on the graph that are at a specific height. This gives us another way to understand the shape or behavior of a function. Here's the formal definition. Definition: a level curve, or a contour, of a function f of two independent variables x and y is a curve of the form k equals f of xy, where k is a constant. This definition actually gives us a method of creating level curves. We simply pick some k values, which correspond to specific heights, and then look at what we have when we set our function equal to those values. Let's look back at the example we used earlier. What is the level curve at height 0? We simply set the left side to 0 and move terms around to get x squared plus y squared equals 4. In other words, we get a circle of radius 2 centered at the origin. Let's look at the trace at height 1. This gives us a circle of radius squared of 3. And at height 2, we get an even smaller circle. When we put these pictures together with a couple more into one graph, we get a contour map. Notice that we've labeled the individual circles so that we can tell which is which. Strictly speaking, the level curves all live on the xy plane, but we can visualize in three dimensions to better understand the shape of the surface. All we need to do is raise these curves to the specified heights, and from this we can start to see the outline of the same shape that we've been looking at earlier. Here it is one more time with the mesh. We can actually understand some of the features of the surface without having to think in three dimensions. Notice that in this collection of level curves, the curves get closer together as the value of k gets smaller. The closeness of these curves is related to the steepness of the surface. If the contour lines are close together, the graph is steep in that area. If there are very few contour lines, it means it's less steep. A practical application of this is reading a topographical map if you're going hiking. This is a topographical map of the land near Nevada State. The level curves correspond to specific altitudes and can be used to understand the shape of the terrain. Where there aren't many contour lines, the land is basically flat. This region is the part of the land that slowly moves uphill towards the base of the mountains. And over here is Mount Scorpion. We can see that there are lots of contour lines, which makes sense because that's a mountain. The USGS has a wide collection of free topographical maps to look at if you want to know more about the shape of the Earth near where you live. The book ends this section with a collection of graphs that are represented in both 3D and as level curves. It is a good exercise to look at these pictures and practice going back and forth between the two pictures. You should also try to think about the shapes of the traces. The online book also provides some links to some web-based graphing tools if you want to explore these things further.